The important question would be, how can you assess value creation in an organization? And this brings us to an important framework by Michael Porter, and that is the value chain framework, which is a well-established model that describes the various value-creating or value-adding activities within an organization. And Porter divided value creation activities into two types, the primary activities and the supporting activities. The primary activities are those that are directly linked to getting goods and services to the customer. That is inbound logistics production, outbound logistics, sales, and marketing. And supporting activities or secondary value chain activities are those that facilitate the primary activities to be performed. And this is these are human resources, finance, and information systems. Now, by being able to categorize these different types of activities that can help your organization to create value, then we have a foundation for creating a strategy that will allow your organization create value and stay competitive in the marketplace. Now, this traditional model has some criticisms, and some of these criticisms, even Michael Porter himself has accepted that something was wrong with the original model. The first criticism is that when you look at the model, it's very much manufacturing oriented. It's mostly reflect manufacturing companies. And second, the model uses a push approach, that is getting products to the customers. And now with the invention of digital technologies, this model has been reevaluated, they have been reconstructed to accommodate some of the changes that are much more relevant for organizations today. And this is the reconstructed model, which starts with market research. And this is recognition of the fact that our activities of an organization has to be driven by creating value to customers. So you start your business by understanding your customers. And that is through market research. And market research should drive new product development. So an organization produces products not just out of passion and feelings, but based on the information received from market research. And then the finished products marketed, procurement of materials, procurement of products, and the management of selling and fulfillment. But the main point with this reconstructed model is the supply chain or the value chain is driven by the market demand and not otherwise. Another way of looking at value creating activities within your organization is through value stream. This is just a different perspective of the value chain. It's just a different way of looking at the same thing with a slight modification. And by value stream, it means the different actions that are performed within your organization that are necessary for value creation. And these activities are divided into three main types. The first type of activity are problem-solving tasks, such as new product development and launching of production. And then you have the information management task, such as order taking, scheduling. And finally, you have the physical transformation task. Now, if you look at this task, it's just rearrangement of the same flows that we have been discussing earlier. So it's just a different way of looking at how value is created in a value chain. Now, after being able, after identifying the activities that add value in your organization, then we need to do what we call value chain analysis. And this is a framework that allows you to break or decompose these activities into individual components and determine how information system or digital business technologies can enhance this activity. As I said earlier, we want to see how digital technologies can help to increase efficiency and effectiveness of a supply chain. So in this case, we are focusing on the value chain, and that is the activities within an organization that result into value creation. And we have used the value chain framework to identify these activities, which could also be identified through the value stream framework. And now we are making value chain analysis to see how digital technologies, information systems, can be used to increase efficiency of these activities. And we have five steps that you can follow in the process of assessing how information systems or digital business technologies can be used to enhance value in your organization. The first step is to assess the information intensity of the value chain. As I said, the digital technologies provide potential for increasing efficiency and effectiveness of your organization when it comes to information flow. So the potential areas that are likely to be enhanced by information systems are those information-intensive areas where information is very important in value creation. So you have to identify all those activities where information is critical. The second, determine the role of information system in the industry structure. The role of information differs from one company to another, from industry to another. So you need to make assessment of how information is necessary in your organization. However, today, as we become more and more data-driven societies, information becomes important almost in every industry, but still the intensity will differ across industries. So you need to determine the role of information system in your organization and assess how will it impact your partners, say distributors, suppliers, and how will your competitors react. So you need to make that assessment. Number three, you need to identify and rank the ways in which information system might create competitive advantage. So you have identified the different activities in your organization and the role of information system for each of these activities. Now you want to rank, to identify and rank different ways through which information system can help your organization achieve competitive advantage in the marketplace. And number four, you have to investigate how information system might result into new businesses. We know today digital technologies provide opportunities for new business models, new pricing models, and so on and so forth. So you need to assess, in case of your organization, how information system can result into new opportunities in the marketplace. And finally, develop a plan for taking advantage of information system. Now, so far we have considered the value chain, which is mostly a consideration of an individual organization and the different activities that are involved in value creation within that organization. But in reality, we know that value creation is not only a result of internal activities, but also could be a result of activities performed by other organizations. And this brings us to the concept of value networks, that the different organizations that your organization is connected to in the process of value creation. So we are moving from a value chain framework where we concentrate on activities within your organization to a much broader picture, which is much more realistic, where we consider other actors or other organizations that help your organization to create value. And these organizations can be categorized into two types: strategic partners and non-strategic partners. In this example, strategic partners have been identified as those that provide inbound logistics, manufacturing, product warehousing, and non-strategic partners are those that provide finance services, human resources, administration activities such as helping you to arrange for travels and such services. However, this is not a rigid structure. It's not the case to every organization. Human resource a company that provides your organization with human resource related services may not be strategic to one organization, but may be strategic to another organization. So it is up to you to identify which partners are strategic and which ones are non-strategic in your case. And these value networks also divide the supply chain in two sides, that you have the buy side or the upstream side, and the sell side or the downstream side. Now, different from value chain framework, the value network first emphasizes on the electronic interconnections between partners and the organization, and directly between partners. That is, with this framework, we appreciate the fact that in order to enhance efficiency and effectiveness, you need to have interconnections with these partners. So the role of digital business technology will not be limited just within your organization, but also be expanded to enhance the relationships with other partners. And in between the organization and other partners, there could be what we call value chain integrators. That is, organizations that facilitate your interaction with your partners. So, for instance, if you're using cloud computing services from Amazon, and it helps you to connect or to interact with your suppliers, this is an example for a value chain integrator. Second, it emphasizes on the dynamic nature of the network. That is, a value chain network is dynamic in the sense that at any point in time, new partners can come in and others can get out. Of course, depending on the nature of the relationships that you have with these partners. And as I said earlier, that you have different types of links that are formed with these partners, and this could include electronic data interchange links that facilitate information between your organization and the various partners that are involved in the relationship. Now, there is an increasing move towards outsourcing, that increasingly companies opt to focus on the core activities of their organizations and outsource or acquire services of other organizations for the activities that are not core to their value creation process. And this tendency goes hand in hand with integration of the organizational operations to operations of other business actors, that is, partners. And this results into what we call a virtual organization, an organization whose physical boundaries between itself and its partners blurs, that become less and less significant. And these are characteristics of visual organizations, that first, there is significant use of communication technologies, and that is in order to connect to different partners. A virtual organization requires intensive use of communication technology. But second, a virtual organization is mobile in the sense that a physical location is not necessary in value creation process, that people or your employees can work anywhere. Take an example of the use of cloud computing, where the computing resources are not tied to a physical location, and your employees can pretty much work from everywhere. And that's an attribute of a virtual organization. And as I say, it has the boundaries are fast, there are less and less boundaries between your organization and your partners, and that is because of the integration between the operations of your organization to those of your partners. And because of all these characteristics, that are ability of your employees to work from anywhere, that is mobility, integration of operations, this provides flexibility and responsiveness to the market's demand. Now, we are talking about using digital business technologies to enhance efficiency and effectiveness in organizations. And this calls for restructuring of supply chain. Whenever you are introducing digital technologies in a supply chain, an organization necessarily will have to undergo restructuring. Now, the question is, how do you carry out restructuring? How do you change the structure of your organization to embrace the digital business technologies? Now, there are different ways you can manage your supply chain, and it ranges from what in a continuum, that an array, from vertical integration, where an organization owns the entire supply chain, or at least you own over 51% of the supply chain, to intermediate situation, which is also referred to as vertical disintegration, or to a situation where you rely on market transactions, that is virtual integration. I will also discuss more about on this. Now, looking at those options, whether you own the supply chain or you own partly use external services, or you depend entirely on market transactions, we have three types of integration. So the first one is vertical integration, and the main characteristics are majority of the operations are done in-house, that you are doing everything yourself, and you have very distant relationship with your suppliers. And this is typical for companies that are producing complex products that is difficult to outsource, or sometimes for intellectual property reasons that you wouldn't like to disclose a production process of a particular product. So instead, you choose to carry out the production in-house. In between, you have the vertical disintegration, where you keep some of the operations in-house, but also you outsource those that are not core to your value creation process. And the goal is mostly to reduce cost and keep your focus on core capabilities. And to the other extreme, you have visual integration, where you are relying on external parties, that much of the activity is outsourced to other parts. And one of the situations where this is applied, where you want rapid market penetration. So for instance, if you have an online store today, you want to penetrate in, say, Denmark, where you would require some physical distribution, instead of doing it yourself, you can outsource that service. And that will help you to achieve faster market penetration. Now, there are three decisions that you have to make when it comes to choice of vertical integration. And this reflects to the structure of a supply chain. The first question is the direction of expansion. And this is, to what extent do you want to own the supply chain, either upstream or downstream? Now, as you can remember last time when we talked about making strategic decisions, this question would differ from one organization to another. Yeah, so you have to analyze the situation of your organization and choose the level of integration that is relevant for your organization. So a company like Apple could pretty much choose to distribute their products through retailers, but it owned part of the distribution system through its online stores and physical stores, and part of it uses other distributors. And that has works strategically to the high advantage of the Apple, because it helps to enhance customer touch points and illustrates on the level of quality that Apple would like to deliver to its customers. So you have to assess to what extent you want to own the supply chain. The second strategic question is the extent of vertical integration, that how far the company should take the downstream and upstream vertical integration. This is in terms of ownership. And this is the last is the balance among the vertically integrated stages. That is, to what extent does each stage of the supply chain focus on supporting the immediate supply chain? That whether you have chosen to own the supply chain or not, or to own to a certain extent, another question is, to what extent do you intend to support your partners, either upstream or downstream? Not necessarily owning them, but providing support. So, as I said earlier, improving supply chain efficiency depends on the ability to enhance or to optimize sharing of information. And the biggest challenge when it comes to information transfer is to achieve standardized data formats, that you have different organizations that are involved in the supply chain, and you want to achieve a standardized data format that can be transferred among these different partners. There are two problems related to information transfer. That is, problem related to transfer of transactional information, such as demand information, demand signals, forecasts, orders, information related to shipping, and also transfer of contextual information. This is has to do with information that relates to interpretation of data. So, for instance, if you decide to change a version of a certain product or change packaging of your product, this will have implication to your suppliers or even distributors. And if this information is not communicated, it will have significant effect on them. And this lack of sharing of such information results in what we call information asymmetry, that at a certain point in time, actors in a supply chain have an equal information. And this leads to inefficiency in a supply chain. So we want to achieve a situation where all actors within a supply chain have equal information, or at least each actor has the relevant information that is necessary for executing their task. So here we have various options and standards for supply chain management when it comes to data sharing. The first one is the electronic data interchange, and this is the method of transfer of data where it's a very simple method of transferring of data, where common types of data are shared between partners within an organization. Many large companies within manufacturing, transportation, employ this in 1980s. But the main weakness is it's a very simple method of data transferring, and it can only transfer a predefined set of data. Another method of transferring data is extensible markup language, which is much more sophisticated than electronic data interchange, and this is what we have today. And it allows what we call one-to-many data sharing, where organizations can share different types of data. And then you have middleware, and these are software that allow transfer of information from one from application running in one computer to another. And the last one is manual email orders. This is a very manual approach where information is shared, among other things, through emails. Now, the most important thing that you need to take with respect to digital information technology is that you have to make sure that information systems or digital information technology facilitate data visibility along the supply chain. You have actors that have different functions or roles within the supply chain, and for that matter, they have different information needs. So you have to make sure that every actor within the supply chain has relevant information at the right time. And this is an illustration of a typical information system infrastructure for a supply chain management, illustrating the different roles in a supply chain framework from the organizational point of view, and how information system can facilitate each of these functions. So in the end, information system help to optimize the flow of information along the supply chain. Now we have the supply chain management strategy process, and if you look at this process, it more or less the same as the generic process for strategy creation. So it starts with situation analysis, just as we saw last week, setting objective, creating a strategy, and then tactics and actions, that is where you take the strategy into action. And then finally, you control, that is, you observe the implementation of the strategy and its results, and see where whether you have achieved the objectives or not. And for an existing supply chain, you have two options, and that is, you can either change the scope of the supply chain, or you can change the speed of the supply chain. And the combination of these two options result into full sales, where if the change in scope is limited, that is, you want to just change a particular process within a supply chain, and this change is imparted just for a short period of time, then we have what we call a process improvement. That is, you have one particular process that is enhanced through digital business technologies within a short period of time to enhance value creation. But if this is done in a long-term perspective, then you have a continuous improvement. So this becomes an ongoing process. But also, you may want to impart the changes in a wider scope, that is, change multiple processes within a supply chain. If this is done in a short term, then you have process integration or disintegration, that is, improvement of different processes within an organization and along the supply chain. And if this is done in a long term, then this will result into radical transformation, that is, the change of the entire supply chain. Finally, we will look at management of partnerships within supply chain, and that is comes intuitively because, as I said earlier, the supply chain involves different actors, and you need to have interconnections among these actors in order to deliver products to the from the point of origin to end customers. So we are looking at how we can manage relationships. So it's very important that you examine your relationships as part of restructuring your supply chain and take the necessary steps to enhance the relationships that will result into efficient and effective supply chain. There are three factors that you need to consider. The first one is you need to begin by focusing on core competencies. And if necessary, you need to think about reducing the number of suppliers. An example of reducing number of suppliers is what Apple did in 1998 when the current CEO, Tim Cook, was hired as the manager for the Apple supply chain. One of the things that he did was to reduce the number of suppliers. At that time, Apple had 100 suppliers, and one of the strategic decisions that Tim Cook did was to reduce the number of suppliers from 100 to 24. And you can imagine, by doing that, you are creating competition among these suppliers, because a lot of them will miss business, and in order to continue to be suppliers for Apple, they will have to enhance the value they create to Apple. So in some cases, it may be necessary to restructure your supply chain. Now, if you have read Steve Jobs' biography, you will understand that at that time, 1997, 1998, Apple was almost at the brink of collapse. And one of the things that, of course, Tim Cook is not accredited much for is the restructuring of the supply chain that he did. Not many people talk about that, and most of people recognize him after becoming the CEO, but he had played a fundamental role in restructuring performance of Apple through restructuring of his supply chain. And then create strong partnerships with your partners, because these are organizations that are critical to value creation of your mission of your organization. And depending on how you want to manage your supply chain, these are the options. This is an entire continuum from total ownership of the supply chain to full market governance, where everything, all transactions are performed on a discrete fashion, that whenever you need a particular input, you go out to the market and find a supplier, and once they deliver the product, your relationship ends there until next time you are looking for something else. But to the other extreme, you are owning that process. So you can assess where you want to fit your organization along this continuum. And these are the characteristics and the level of deployment of digital business technologies. Now, the last aspect that I will talk about is management of global distribution. That at some point, you may want to expand the operations of your business by penetrating other markets. Now, it may be impractical, either for financial reasons or for other technical aspects, to penetrate that market yourself. So you may need partners in new markets. Now, these are some of the guidelines that you have to take into consideration when you select partners in a foreign market. Guideline number one is do not let the partners select you, but rather you should select the partners. And this is very intuitive that you are expected to set your criteria and select partners that fit into those criteria. You have to look for distributors that are capable of developing markets rather than those with new customer contracts. You want to penetrate in the market and you want to look for a partner that is capable of developing that market for your business. Third, treat the local distributors as long-term partners and not temporary market entry vehicles. You have to treat them as partners, and this is because whenever a partner realizes that you're only using them as a vehicle for entering into the market, and sooner or later, whenever you are establishing that market, you will abandon them, they will also act opportunistically. That is, they will try to take advantage of you before you take advantage of them. So you have to treat your distributors as long partners, and they have to feel that way. You have to support market entry by committing money, managers, and proven marketing ideas. So in some cases, you have to help local distributors in terms of financial investments to strengthen the market whenever necessary. And since you are the one that you know how your product should be best delivered, so in some cases you have to help them with training or even providing managers for helping their operations. You have to maintain control over marketing strategy, and this is a very important aspect of your business. Make sure distributors provide you with detailed market and financial performance data. You have to track what they are doing and make sure that it goes in accordance to your strategic plan. And finally, build the links among national distributors at the earliest opportunity. That, because we are looking at it as a value chain network, you want to connect these distributors in terms of sharing information, sharing their experiences, sharing competence in order to enhance value creation. And that's it. So now I will quickly go through the next assignment. So this is the second assignment and the last one, part 2B. And of course, this will be the last one. The deadline is 31st of March. I'll speak more about the deadline. But now I'll focus on what you are required to do in this assignment. In the first assignment, you came up with a business idea and the value proposition for customers that will for your prospective customers. And then in the second assignment, each one of you was required to give comments and feedback to other groups. Not everyone has done that, but you are supposed to, as I will say it at the end of this assignment. In this assignment, which is divided into two parts, the first part is creation of a business model. And that is, you will elaborate on how your business will create value, how you will provide that value or deliver value to your customers, and how you will capture value. That is, how you will generate revenue from your business. To do it in a very simple way, use the business model canvas framework that we learn about in lecture number 5, which provides you with all the aspects that are required to enter into a business model. So I expect you, in the elaboration of your business model, to include all these aspects. You already have value proposition from the first assignment. Now I want you to discuss customer segments. Which customer segments are you intending to serve? How are you going to maintain relationships with your customers? Which channels are you going to use to get your products to your customers? Which key partners may be relevant for your organization? Which activities, the actual activities that you will perform to create value in your organization? Which resources, both human resources, technological, financial, you have to elaborate on all these resources that you need. Estimate cost structure. And cost structure actually is based on the activities and resources, that the amount of resources or the type of resources and the amount that you will need, as well as the activities, will detect the cost structure of your organization. So I want you also to elaborate on that. And finally, the revenue. How are you going to generate money? How are you going to charge your customers? How are they going to pay for your product? So this is part one. The second part, I wanted to create a strategy for your business. And this will not be a complete strategy, but I just wanted to create part of the strategy. And you can use the balanced scorecard as a framework for this assignment. So you tell me the vision, the mission of your organization, and I want you to set objectives. So for instance, what objectives do you have in serving your customers? And how are you going to measure those objectives? That I want you to tell me, say, in 2-3 years, I will evaluate myself whether I have achieved this objective or not through this criteria. It's not necessary that you have 4 objectives. It could be 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever number that is relevant for your business. And likewise, for learning and growth, because your business has to accommodate the changes that happen in the marketplace. So I want you to tell me, how are you going to stay innovative in your market? So likewise, do the same for financials and internal business process. Now, as I said, the first assignment and second assignment, some of you delivered it as the instructions required, but the deadlines we had before were mostly for trying to help you develop something. Because being a student myself, I understand. Sometimes when you have a long deadline, it's very easy to believe that you will do it in the last minute. So those deadlines were mostly to help you get along with assignment. But this deadline is rigid. And that is, after 31st of March, I will not accept any delivery of any part of the assignment. And that is because on 15th of April, a list of those that qualify for the final exam will be released. So it's very important that you keep with that deadline. And the way I want it to appear, I'll use an example from one of your colleagues. So in the first assignment, I said you have to provide a business idea and state value proposition. And this, the number of ideas depends on the number of participants in your group. The idea is each one of you has to contribute at least one idea, just to help each one of you participate in this process. So you have 4 ideas. Now, if by 31st of March you are, say, 4 in the group, and I find only 3 ideas, then I will ask you to tell me who did not provide an idea. And of course, that means will be a failure, and you will not be allowed to take the final exam. So if you have 4 ideas, then I will not bother who contributed the idea. But if you have less than what is required, then I will ask for who contributed and who did not. In the second assignment, I said you have to give comments to another group. In the assessment of your assignment, I want you to have a section in your website where you provide the comments that you gave to another group and the group that you gave comments to, as well as the comments that you received from another group. And the last part is today's assignment. So the assessment will be, I will look at the first part, that is, I have to see all the four ideas, and then the comments that you gave to other groups, and those you received from other groups. And in the last part, you select one idea that you will use to do today's assignment, that you develop a business model and develop a balanced scorecard for your organization, just for one idea. So in case of, say, this group, they will choose one idea that they think is best, based on their own opinion and based on the comments you have received, and then you will develop a business model. And this will be a strict evaluation. If any part of this that I have said will miss, then you may consider yourself a failure. So you have quite substantial time to work on this. That's it. Is there a question? All right, so I'll see you on Friday. Det skal jeg gjøre det. Ja.
So I have a question. How could we be sure that you received everything that we send to you? Because I'm not used to use Frontier or this kind of website, so I don't know how really to use it.
Okay.
I'm the Erasmus student, so yeah, I don't really know how it works. So
okay. The thing is, did you send your website?
Yeah, I've done everything, but I don't know if you received
it. Okay. So I have your link,
and the thing is, for the second assignment, you gave us a website, because the thing is, you didn't receive our, because I am with another French guy, and you didn't receive the first assignment before the due date, but we sent it to you.
Yeah.
So then you, I don't know if you remember this story, but and then you give us to. Website that we have to analyze, but there is no the part comments on the website.
Exactly.
And there was not email address. So we send it to you because.
Okay, so the thing is, with this assignment I've said, what you are required to do on your website.
Yeah. Choose one.
Yeah, and then. Tell me which comments did you give to the other group. So you. Open a page and paste those comments that you gave to other group. And if you received any...
How can I give it to the other group? I don't have an email address or something. I don't have even a mail name.
And that is their problem.
Yeah.
So once you have those comments, keep it on your page, right?
On my page? I mean on my website?
Yeah. So you tell me these are the comments I gave to this group, right?
Okay.
I didn't have anywhere to place.
Okay.
And that is their problem, because as part of the assignment, they are supposed to show me on their website the comments they received from you, whether they received it through email or any other means, but I want to see them, I want them to show me.
So
yeah.
So the comments must be on their website?
Yeah.
Because we send it to you, to your...
No, it has to be on their website, because ideally, I want them these comments to help them in the selection of the best idea.
Okay. So what I have to do is copy paste their website, do another website, and add my comment.
Yeah.
And then what I have to do with this new website? Send it to you or send it?
No, the website is yours, right? You have a website.
Yeah, I have a website.
Then you take those comments that you would send to someone else, to another group.
Yeah.
And then paste it on your website.
On my website?
Yeah.
But it doesn't have any report, because I've done two ideas, but I'm going to comment something that is not on my website.
No, you have a section, and you tell me these are the comments I gave, because that's the part of the assignment.
Got it. All right.
Yeah, these are comments that I gave to group number so and so.
Got it.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then it's done.
Okay. I'll do it.
Yeah. Yep, see you.